Hello, everybody. Good morning. Well, my task is obviously to wake people up in the morning. I hope you had a good breakfast and slept well this night. And I would like to talk a little bit about the DebianMed project, but it's not really directed to medicine, biology, or what we are doing. It's rather, I would like to give an example how the DebianMed project worked and what we possibly did right, as I'd like to show. And yeah, how many people are considering themselves in the DebianMed project here in the room? 1, 2, 3, okay. Who has never heard about DebianMed before? Okay. Who has never raised his arm now? Oh, okay. Thank you. Okay, I will tell you a little bit about past, present, and future, and I think of the DebianMed project for sure, and I'd like to outline what I think could be a model for other projects to get a similar success. Maybe you have read the in my abstract that the DebianMed project even is quite unimportant for Debian, has gathered one developer per year, who confirmed that they are only developers because the DebianMed project exists, which makes more than 1% of the Debian developers at all. But what? How did the project start? Basically, it was an idea driven by some wine, some good Bordeaux wine at DebConf 1. And the question of the day was how to translate the installation instruction for some medical program. And I think translating installation instruction is quite stupid. We have a packaging system. And so I decided to have my first talk about packaging. And I'm sorry for this interruption here. And this was held on the next day. And after I had this talk, I thought, well, let's make a real project, which I started in 2002. And in 2015, so more or less 15 years after the idea was born, I told to John Maddock Hall, possibly everybody will know him, that after 15 years I'm working for something. People are starting using it. And it was a little bit that I was not really happy about that it's such a long time. And his answer was, only 15 years. You young guys should be more patient. I should hurry up, since after 15 years I might be dead, but you have so much time. So this, I think this is kind of sanity and helps if you think that my project is not going forward as fast as it should. And it made me think that we somehow have done something right and are even right in time. So what was the motivation to create the DebianMed project? Well, in Debian, it is possible. We have a duocracy. I don't know if everybody's familiar with the term duocracy. It is, if you do something, you decide what gets done, and nobody will stop you. And this is kind of good principle, because it leaves a lot of freedom for the individual, and you have a good idea, and if you are very motivated to do it and you really want to get it done, then you can get it done. What is my view on Debian? Well, you see, a user has a computer and wants to install a lot of packages, a lot of software. And this software is mostly done, or was mostly done, by one developer, and you have a package developer relation. My first package was WordNet. I will tell about Friday on this one. But the thing is, we have in Debian lots of these packages. I don't know the current number, it's 50,000 or so. So if you are a new user, and you are a specific user, you are really confused about all these packages. How can I really find the package I really need? And the answer to this, in my opinion, is so-called blends. We have a kind of a Scala Linux Debian Edu blend. We have a Debian Mate blend. We have a Debian GIS blend. We have more than this. But the thing is, the blend gives the user a focus on the package he really wants to use. So he doesn't need to seek all the pool for lots of software. He can just use what the blend is presenting him. And the blend is nothing else than Debian, but it gives you a different view on the package pool, a more simple view for the user who has a certain interest in some topic. For instance, if you consider the usual biologist who wants to do some DNA sequencing, then he installs the so-called biological task of the Debian Mate project. It's a meta package called MateBio. And this has dependencies, and he just installs a single program, or a single package, and gets all these packages and even more. And in the Debian Mate team, we have also maintainers. You see my face quite frequently. It's also not really really what's presenting it, because in the Debian Mate team, we have more than one maintainer per package, at least in the good case. Or at least we are gaining for more people per package than only one to make it more reliable. So this is basically the view we can provide. And for every other topics, we have similar meta packages. And so people with other work interests can easily install these packages. Inside the Debian Mate project, we have several so-called tasks. You here see the biology task with a lot of packages, more than 500. So you can do development of biological applications. This is not so high bar, but well, we have more applications than development support. We have a little bit to support epidemiologists. We have very, very few to support hospitals. This is HIS, this hospital information systems. I will tell you a little bit more about this. We have quite good coverage for medical imaging and development of medical imaging applications. We have two packages where doctors can maintain their practice, a little bit more viewers and so. We have some packages to work in psychology. It's basically maintained by the NeuroDebian team. And we have some tools. But the very interesting thing in this graph is if you look at the first 5 years, well, it's not really gaining traction. It was nothing, though. Maybe the thing is that I'm kind of an endurance sportman and have some long breaths to work with things which are not really developing and really had hope that it will work. And the point why it rise that steeply is that we were able to form a good team which comes from different from different institutions, have different interests and are packaging what they need. And this is the point of blends in general. We want to collect all people with a similar need in their work, and they will concentrate on things to do something in common, to make for all of them a good system. And this graph is also a little bit reflecting that once we have met, it was in 2011, we are doing sprints. The slope is even more steep. So sprints and meetings are quite important. You can all see this on this one graph. I have other graphs which are showing basically the same. So in short, you need to be some kind of endurance athlete to do a long-term goal. You need to find friends in Debian, and you should meet. This graphic tells you all this. And what's the definition of a team? For me, it's just waking up in the morning and realize that somebody else have solved your problem from yesterday. I actually experienced this not only once. well, sitting down on my computer Saturday evening, getting tired, writing email to the list, opening my laptop in the next morning while laying in the bed. That's my habit, sorry. My wife does not really like it, but I'm doing it anyway. Yeah, the problem was solved. There was a push in the version control system. And this is something I really like. And if you are at this point, then your project is evolving. It took about 10 years, 12 years to this point. So I'm just telling you, because if you know that this might happen, you can gain for this. Oh, by the way, you can always interrupt me in my talk, right? We are just a small group. Raise your hand, get the microphone, and ask. What are our ways to get a stronger team? I think a basic point is to be a Debian developer, you need a certain knowledge. The knowledge about packaging is actually not really something secret. It's if you can code, you can write a made file. That's basically what we are doing. We are doing some scripts. So any programmer should be able to build a Debian package. But this knowledge is, well, it's good documented, but you know who reads documentation. This knowledge should be provided more easily. And my idea was we can do the following. I'm running the so-called mentoring of the month and show that Debian packaging is easy. I have some constraints. I request open discussion. I do not accept private emails. The idea is other persons may have the same problem and they can read it on the public mailing list and solve it without asking again. And I also think that I'm not the only one who knows good advice, and other people might give better advice, additional comments. So open discussion is a requirement. And we work together for about 1 month. It might last longer, it might be shorter. And the mentee can ask any question. There is no such thing like a stupid question. And even if it was asked before, or there is a FAQ or so, we will not punish this. It should be very relaxed for the mentee to enter the project. So the mentee is kindly invited to learn packaging in a friendly environment. It's important. I do not remember real flame wars on our mailing list. Maybe we are too few. We are about maybe 50 people on the mailing list. But it's usually a friendly list. And we also are trying hard to attract upstream, since the authors of some software are in principle the best packagers, because they know the software, they know where the packages, where the files should be directed to, they know some configuration stuff. And so usually if some upstream approach us, could you create a Debian package of my software? I usually invite him to do this mentoring of the month for two reasons. One is that everybody has this to-do list, and it's hard to put something in between, so I usually can't immediately solve the problem and create the package. So this is one point. And the other point is, if I train upstream to do the work, he will continue to work. And the effort I put on teaching will in the long term be rewarded by not being forced to do the work over and over again. The conclusions from this mentoring of the month are, as I said, the time I spend into mentoring is a very worth the effort. I do not really have a student each month, so the workload is bearable. It's maybe 3 to 4, maybe 5 students per year. And it depends how involved the student is, how much effort I need to spend. Some students are very quick and I do not have much work. And sometimes the packages they are trying to build are a little bit harder and then it takes longer. It depends. It is also good for me to teach the students because I have read the documentation about 10 years ago in the best case. They have read the really recent documentation and I can even learn something from them. That's good for me, so I would invite you all to teach some newcomers to learn the current stuff. The major advantage is that training ups team is somehow pooling the knowledge about the code and our packaging, and so this is very efficient, as I tried to explain. And actually 50% of the students have some strong connection to upstream, either are upstream themselves or they have a very good connection and they are known in the bug tracker and can provide patches and so on. And another 50% is not all people who are joining the mentoring of one stay in the project. This is also a wrong expectation. If we get about 50% of those people, that's good. And then we are doing sprints. Sprints are meetings, and Debian is also fun, right? You know Gunnar Wolf, he's also organizing here. He's quite a known person. And I once wrote him that I didn't told him that we are doing the sprint, and my punishment was that I need to stand for three minutes in the 5 degrees cold water. But next time we will tell him before, and he said, oh, I understand. I thought Debian made focus on packaging medical software. With this note you mentioned and your choice of location, however, I understand better. After meeting every year, you need medical attention, possibly including a psychiatric evaluation. But anyway, so he invites us to Mexico with better conditions. So, yeah, maybe he's right, but well, usually I say, in some aspect, everybody here in Debian is a little bit crazy. It's different than the usual person on the street. That's fine. So, my wife considers me as quite normal in the scope of the Debian developers. Well, that's a compliment. So, about the team. Oh, well, I want to say more about the sprints. I'm sorry. We are meeting once a year, and this happens mostly in winter time on the beach because hotels are cheaper there. You should make sure that there is a good bandwidth connection, which was kind of not working all the time. And we are about 10 to 15 people there. About half of them is constantly coming. Sasha is close to always coming. And other people are coming only once and don't remain in the project. But that's not important. We are meeting, and as I've shown on the graph before, the meeting are really pushing the number of output we have. So this is really important. And Debian is supporting these meetings. We 4 or 5 Debian developers who usually attending, we get the travel costs refunded. And thanks to Debian for this. The funding is partly also done by local organizations. We were once supported by the University of Rennes when we did this meeting also. You find some sponsors. This works also somehow. And as I said, it's quite important. Yeah, this graph really shows what team maintenance means. It is not as positive the outcome as I would like to have it, but I will explain it. It's not switched on. This bar shows the number of packages which are in version control system only touched by a single person. I would like to have this graph drop to zero. Say, well, every package is touched at least by 2 persons. This would be the goal. We are far away from this goal. If you look at the comparable graph of the Pearl team goes like this. Well, this is a goal. We are not there. And even this bar says, well, two people are looking at it. But, well, if you know the interns, it's in frequent cases, say half here is somebody started the package and I took over. So I'm the second one, which, yeah, this person vanished and I just keep on working. So it's, we can do better here. But anyway, we have packages which are maintained by 3 to 4 people. That's a start. We try to get better. We have, I create these graphs in so-called team statistics project. You can have your graphs for several teams and just ask me if your team is not amongst it, I can create it. It's quite interesting because we have some teams where you have only one bar and then it drops very, very strongly. So just check it for your team. Now I come to a point I'm very proud about because I did some questionnaire. We have a group of developers, either Debian developers or Debian maintainers. Debian maintainer concept is known. Who doesn't know what is a Debian maintainer? Well, Debian developer like me. Yeah, Debian developer like me and Sasha and so. We are official members of Debian. We have voting rights and we have upload rights. Well, the step before is, or not the step before. If you are not a Debian developer, you need to ask me. I have prepared a package. Please upload it, and I will do it for you. That is called sponsoring. And assume I have sponsored you for 2 years, and I know your package is okay, and I'm bored by always looking at it. You can become a Debian maintainer, and you get whitelisted for this specific package to, and get upload right for your package. This is a Debian maintainer, and so we have, I don't know exact relation, maybe 28 DDs and 2 DMs or so. The Debian maintainer status is in most cases, the step before you get an official Debian developer, because then you, once you are a Debian maintainer, you want to have it right and become voting rights and so on. So this is the team. And I was asking myself, what attracted the people to come to Debian? I have also for my other talk on Friday, I just wrote to the mailing list, please write down your motivation to come to Debian. And I asked the explicit question, who is a Debian developer just because Debian Mate exists? So if Debian Mate wouldn't exist, would it be Debian developer or not? And interestingly, 16 of the DDs confirmed, yes, if the Debian Mate project would not exist, I would not be a DD because Debian would not be so interesting for me. And well, these 40 Ds, they were there before Debian Mate existed. If Debian Mate existed before I was in Debian, I would also have joined Debian because of this. What does it mean? Well, actually, if I'm honest, Debian Mate is not very important for Debian itself. If there is biology stuff and medicine stuff inside or not, it's not important. Red Hat hasn't it in this amount. People are using Red Hat anyway. So the Debian Mate project itself is not important. But this quite unimportant project has gathered 16 developers. This is more than 1% of the Debian developers. So the lesson we can learn here is if I have an attractive project which fits my topic, I can make Debian way more strong than it is currently. So the main idea of my talk is please create a blend around your topic and gather developer for Debian. And it's not only in the project because 10 of these 16 people extended their activity to other fields in Debian. So they came via Debian Mate and now doing other very good things for Debian. I think this is also a very important thing. I do not want them to stay here. Sascha is also doing other stuff. So it's, yeah. It's important for Debian that we try to get new developers. And not all of them are even active in Debian Mid anymore. They, only 13 of them, 3 drifted away to other fields. Right? That's also perfect. Okay. So, again, make Debian attractive for a certain user group, and you draw from there new developer power. Who's using Debian Mid? Well, the short answer is we don't know. We can't know. You can download it from the internet. That's a typical thing for Debian. We just don't know. We have some popularity contests. Popularity contest is, if you install Debian, you get the question, do you want to submit data about your packages you are using to some server on the internet? And if you hear yes, then the data is published. And please do so. We are not spying your computer. It is encrypted, it is anonymized, and it is the actual data is not visible for the public, but only the aggregated data. So if you say yes for the popcorn, we get your data, and we know what packages are interesting for you, and we put more effort on these packages. That's for your profit. So most probably, we have more users than popcorn numbers are showing, since the default value for popcorn is no, because we care about your privacy. But please, this is probably the only default value you should switch on the installer. Please switch it from no to yes. And we also don't know how many users are using our work via derivatives. As far as I know, in biology, Ubuntu is quite popular, so probably 10 times more users are using our packages via Ubuntu. This is fine, this is okay. I will not blame anybody about using Ubuntu. My opinion is that there is some drawback because in Debian, we are faster. We are a team behind these packages, and we are doing backports, and you would get way more fluent and way more current packages if you are using the biology package via Debian. So use whatever system you want, but my suggestion is, in the specific topic, Debian is better for you. I had some example that a colleague of mine, or former colleague of mine, needed some package. I did the packaging with 2 reverse dependencies. Everything was done, and I asked him, are you happy now? He said, it's not available for Ubuntu. I said, well, you need to rebuild this only, and then, yeah, I can't do it. So the question is, if Ubuntu is easier to use or Debian, I can't decide, but if it fits your topic, that might be interesting. And we have other derivatives. We have, for instance, BioLinux. BioLinux was an Ubuntu derivative doing some doing some interesting stuff, more visible on the desktop, and some adaptation of the desktop and so on, and maybe some additional packages. But the good thing was the BioLinux developers were joining our sprints, were using our version control system, and so they put their development effort together with us. And this was really good. And so they developed in Debian and then built their system on Ubuntu, which is fine. Sometimes we know about the usage if there are some publications. There was some publication with the quote, Welcome Trust Sanger Institute is maybe the largest institution in Europe, which is doing bioinformatics, and they have a really, really large system running at this time. They called it the biggest Linux web partition, and they were using Debian. They even even 2 or 3 Debian developers worked there, not really using Debian Med packages as far. They were not, Sascha was working there and he was, but before Sascha there were also some people, I forgot the name, but they were joining DebConf in Edinburgh, but they did not really join the Debian Med team, they did other stuff. Maybe we were not as good at this time, I don't know. So, if I'm talking about Debian Med, why I'm talking so much about bioinformatics? The reason is simple. We have most of the free software in the field of bioinformatics. When I started with Debian Med, we had in Debian 5 to 10 packages covering this field, mostly offhand. This was my start to de-offhand them and update them and take them over. So, bioinformatics is very good covered in Debian Med. And thus in Debian, because we are in Debian. We have a very good, we have also a good coverage of medical imaging. Something is missing, which we should package, which is quite complex with Java stuff, with sets, non-free licenses and need to be freed. So this is also something we are actively doing. We have, we are approaching upstream and please use a free license. We have also a wiki page where we list where we succeeded with this. And where we are work, we have work in progress. This is one of the most boring jobs you can do in Debian, but it's somehow needed. And the good thing is, if you are successful and have a list of success, it is more inspiring for other people to do it as well. We have something for medical practice. It's called GNUMed and FreeMed forms. GNUMed is basically developed in German in FreeMed forms in France. It had some, yeah, it implements somehow also country-based healthcare system. GNUMed is internationalized, should be work in other countries as well, but it's definitely nothing the general practitioner should just install on this computer and start running this practice. The general practitioner should care for the patient and not for the computer. Should hire an IT person. So it's not that bad that we have only two, because if Debian provides a solid base with some diagram viewers which are used in the practice, and so several things are packaged, not actually the management system, but something which is used in a practice, which is also some help. And for hospitals, we have, well, I would say close to nothing. We have one thing, which is FIS GTM. It is kind of a database which is used by the system Vista. Vista is a very old hospital management system, way older than before Windows Vista and so. This is the only very powerful hospital management system I know, and we have at least the database it's running upon. The system itself is so complex that people told us it's, you can't package it. I'm not really convinced, but I also can't do the work and prove them wrong. So it's hard to do. And the good thing is we got this FIS GTM in the first Mentoring of Months project, because it's also very complex and has a very skilled mentee, and we worked very good together, and finally we have at least this. And what we can provide to hospitals is a very stable and reliable operating system. Not specific with the adaptations they need, but we are the universal system, right? Well, the first when I first mentioned the name Debian Med, people immediately assume, I have the prejudices, that we are developing code to maintain patient data. I'm sorry, that's not the case. We just provide what exists as free software and do it as best as possible. So if some free software exists to manage a medical practice, then we are packaging this and help you. And as I said, the doctors should always consult an IT professional to run their practice. There are some problems with certifications in certain healthcare systems, but there are also solutions. For instance, I mentioned this in the first talk here on the open day, because taxes are also, or in, I don't know, was it in Germany or not, taxes should be provided by some proprietary software to not expose the data to somebody who can hack, could hack into it. This was what people said, and say, well, that's actually stupid, because in the patient data should also not manipulate it. And the solution is the system creates a hash zoom over the data set and moves them to a different server, a notification server, and there it is stored with another hash zoom, cryptographically ensured. And so you can always prove that the data were manipulated or not. So the certification authorities should think about not hiding the data to not becoming manipulated, but making sure that it's be provable that the data are not manipulated, and that can be perfectly done with free software. Well, for the biologists, you have some practical issues that biologists are updating the, their system to Debian Stable about every second year, and in Debian Mate we try to release software via backports to have the current data. The problem is one scientist needs a stable version for a long time, and the other one needs a very up to date or last published version. And so we try to get some solution with containers, virtual machines, or so, to install them as quick as possible and to make the access to this as fast as possible. Well, the main point of my talk is, in the last century we had a one-to-one relation, maintainer per package, and then started team maintenance. Team maintenance means you have M maintainers, more than one, and one package. But in blends, we are creating maintainers for packages, also an M2P relation. It's not one-to-one, it's any number of maintainers with any number of packages. So it's rather a team-to-topic relation. And this actually makes blends, in my opinion, way stronger than any other approach to the package pool. And also this makes blends the missing link between upstreams and users of some specific topic. This is the main point, and my opinion is the point why we are able to gather so many people. So now it's up to you. We had the talk in 2013, Ashish Loraya said, it's in the video about 30:33, we should try hard to run around asking users and developers, is there any topic you care about, create a blend today. I asked him 2 years later if he was running around to create a, no, he didn't. But maybe you will. So if you want to like this team topic relation, create a blend today. And I will help you here at DevConf or remotely. And so maybe even you are able to attract one DD per year just by following the Debian Mate example. Yeah, this is what I wanted to tell you. The talk is available here. You can also Google for Andreas Tille talks and you will get a link. Are there any questions? So, is anybody running some or working in some team with a certain topic which might be interesting? No, not yet. Do you need more coffee?
If we have not bucket already in Debian, we could start to work in Debian Mate since the beginning, since without any knowledge about Debian packaging, and we could learn here.
Yeah, that's the goal. So assume you are, you need, if people ask me, how can I contribute to Debian Mate? I ask them, what package or what program are you using which is not yet packaged? And if there is such a thing, then I said, then let's start packaging this one, because this is some software you are interested in. And you are catched more by something you are interested in than by some random WNPP package, right?
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, there's another.
So I'm not a DD or anything, but I'm planning on getting involved, and I'm wondering if you see any difference between sort of explicit teams in Maine, like, you know, the Perl team or the JavaScript team or whatever, and blends.
Well, no, there is actually no difference. It's just the topic what they're doing. The topic of the Perl team is Perl libraries, right? And the topic of DBMA team is, it's just technically harder because we have to deal with all languages. And Perl has a focused developer team. But we adopted, for instance, the policy of the Debian Perl team. We adopted it and used it and tweaked it a bit. So it's very similar, but we found a different name to distinguish from technical teams to topic teams. But there is, in principle, no difference.
Does anyone have another question?
If not, thank you for your attendance. See you next time, and tell me if you created a blend.
Thank you, Andreas.
Thank you.